few minutes looking. There's a couple. I can't speak to the accuracy of either of them, other than to say this one, something called Objectus Video, has a demo version that is fully functional. It doesn't allow you to like save any output, but you don't need to, save a movie as an output, but you don't need to do that. It describes a feature down here, Polygon, which is used for tracking objects and identifying an object path. So that's what you want. So that's a potential. The other one that I would say is potentially more likely to be exactly what we want is this thing called Fizmo. It is fully free, and it builds itself as a video motion analysis program primarily for high school physics, which like is perfect. So that's two additional suggestions that you could use. Okay, so hopefully those would work out. I think they're available in the app stores. Okay. And then otherwise, if you happen to be more Windows based, or you have a Windows emulator on your Mac, then VideoPoint works just fine. And then a few of you, did indicate that there was like an initialization failure or something, it didn't work initially, but that was likely because QuakeTime wasn't there. And I think once we took that into account, it was fine. Okay, so I'm gonna focus on this one, the sort of angular velocity to tangential velocity. And so the point of this is, like, do the calculations of angular velocity give up the tangential velocity that we would expect? Okay, so we gotta measure the tangential velocity, we gotta measure the angular velocity. And the radius, because tangential velocity is angular velocity times radius. Okay, so we have to have both of those. Okay, so here's what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna go from, I'm gonna look at the ball like going through, how long does it go take to go from essentially this location, which to me that looks like pretty flat, let me say. Like pretty much horizontal between like the axis and the ball. Everybody's okay with that? Good enough for our work. So that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, 31, 32, 33, 34, 35, 26, 27, 28, 29, 40. That looks fine. And like you could have figured that out that 40 frames was giving you like this number here based on the fact that it has a 30 frame per second expected time, but I just counted them out. It seemed quicker. Okay, great. So, I need to do one of these. All right, so the angle was what it is pi divided by 2, right? That's like a quarter turn. I've seen odds, so I'm going with that. And then that was the displacement. How many frames did I say? 40? 40. I think you guys have a good memory. 40 divided by 250, because I'm pretty sure that was the frame rate of that many seconds. So I'll call that the period. Angular velocity. Is something in rads per second. And that's just one. This divided by that. Okay, so 9.8 radians per second, purely coincidental that it's the same number as the acceleration. Okay, The next thing we want to know is, like, what is this radius? So I'm just going to click there and click here. Well, that's cool. Got it. And so I want the length of this segment, right? And so if you're thinking to yourself, okay, what is the length of the line between two points? And you're scratching your head and it doesn't like, oh yeah, it's right there. Then you can easily Google that stuff up. Otherwise, it's the change in the X is squared plus the change in the Y is squared, all of that square root. I happen to know these things because it's kind of my area. I feel like I'm responsible. I'm irresponsible if I don't know some of this stuff, at least off the top of my head. So, there we go. So I'm just gonna put those, we're gonna figure out what the length of the lines is. So here's X2. Oh yeah, that's fine because it was pretty much straight up and down. Yeah, that makes sense. And then these. Something seems terribly wrong.
You added them instead of dividing
them? Wow. I made all sorts of mistakes here. How embarrassing. How big is it? Is that big, easy enough to see from the green goods are, or did I try to?
0.5. You
can
go back 5 and 2.
Yeah, I know, I got it. I just wanted to try and make it big enough so that you could see. It really hasn't changed anything except for the size of the text, didn't you? So it's the X's, 5 minus 4 squared plus the Y's. 262 minus 119 squared, and then this should be 0.5, not 2. Okay, so we got 143 pixels. Sounds good. Per second, we want that to be in meters, and so we're going to have to adjust that, right? And we talked the other day about a calibration coefficient that we determined previously. I'm going to show you again. So, is equal to 70 inches, so that's the other part that's critical. And 70 inches is this many centimeters. No, meters. 1.778. Okay, so we get a And then, calibration vector, that's what we're trying to do. It gives us an amount of pixels per meter, 182, which I think is about what we had the other day. It's a good situation. So we have 143 pixels, and we know it's going to be less than a meter. How much less? It's 0.78 centimeters. Sorry, 0.78 meters. 78.5 centimeters. Okay, well, great. So that's cool. So now we got radius. We know what that is. Is that. And so we expect the tangential velocity to be something like this times that, 7.7. Makes sense?
That's the angular velocity times the radius.
Yeah, that's the formula for tangential velocity. I think we probably get it too. Okay, so now, like, what is it? What was it? Was it the same, bigger, less? So that's where the digitization bit comes in. You don't need that movie anymore. Reason for this, we only need one spot. And here, we got to set up, okay, so there's a circular and a linear portion to this. And I don't need to go too far back. And for one reason, mostly I don't want to bore you too much watching somebody digitize this. Just long enough for you to recognize that, all of us do this. It's not that bad, even if, something screws up and you end up having to do it a second time. What is the speed of the ball like along here? Okay. Good with that? There's at least two or three different ways that you could attack that particular issue. I'm going to maybe talk to you about several of them. The first idea would be to like turn this into something that is not in pictures. So we just did, it worked out to be something like 182 is the calibration factor, right? 182.23. I don't really care what it is, I'm just using it. So now, instead of being in pixels, my graph is in meters. Okay. So that's cool. And I'm going to, just for the sake of it, because I know we've already done the rotational part, I'm going to turn this all, instead of like, right now it's in, it's formulas here. So I'm just going to copy it and then paste it right back where it is numbers. And the reason why I'm doing that is because I'm going to start deleting the part. This is just what I like to do, and you can do it this way or not. All I'm doing is just deleting the region, so now all I have is the linear bit. Okay, I just got rid of the circle because I didn't like it. And so this is the XY velocity. So I happen to know that it like travels, like moves progressively in the X direction. It doesn't like go backwards. And it starts low in the Y and then goes higher. So I'm going to look for the min values. Min X. That's not exact. I'll write that up in a second. I want the min. This is for future reference. If it had some like unusual trajectory where it was sort of more sinusoidal, you couldn't necessarily do it just like this, but see, as it is fairly simple, it's totally fine. Starts off at 2.27, which there it does. Whole thing. Yeah, looks about right. This looks like somewhere like 2.27. And then up here is 3.2 something. Yeah, looks good. Okay, so I can tell you what the total distance is. In X. Oh, like all of this. So close to a meter. And then so close to 0.5. So we've got the square where it goes a meter that way and 0.5 that way, and we've got to find the hypotenuse of those, right? This is the vector sum. So, distance is this square plus this square, all of it square root. So it traveled 1 meter, 13 centimeters. We'll call it the period, which is the time elapsed to do so. Eight. drum roll. It sure would be good if it worked out. Because it's kind of supposed to. 4.2.
Shh, nice.
And we were expecting 7.7. So the only thing I can think of that happened is Michelle didn't have a good release of the ball. Because this physical law predates like all of us and most of modern society. So it's been worked over like again and again. I don't know what you're about. But the point of this is not so much like do the numbers really agree, it's like undertaking the effort. And then making sure you can monitor, you have an idea as to like how to measure things from the video, both temporally, like across time, and location for kinematics or whatever it might be. So that's the main bit. We calibrated it, turned it from pixels into something usable. We measured like rotational motion by like visually inspecting the trajectory and knowing that, okay, that looks like a quarter of a turn. And then we digitized it, tracked the video points. Then we went to the segment that we were most interested in. We analyzed that. We made sure that we had the correct time scale to back up to reality. And then we compared the numbers, and it turned out, like, from the physical side of things, it didn't make as much sense as we would expect, but that's, our method was correct. Okay. So that's that approach. With respect to the activities we did a couple of weeks ago, one of the other ones was a biking event, which, there's no data or figures necessary, but the computations are essentially power is equal to torque times velocity in the angular frame. And torque times angular velocity. If that's what I said, then great. But it is torque times angular velocity. Angular velocity for us was measured in revolutions per minute, which is not radians per second, which is the traditional unit. So you'd have to make some small change there. And we were interested in like how the forces that we applied to the pedal changed as a result of augmenting or decrementing the cadence. So radius, I think, on the bike crank is set at 16.5 centimeters. I think that's right. Pretty sure. And so from that, you can figure out force times the radius times the angular velocity is going to give you the power, which we set constant for your subject in like the three different instances, but it did vary between subjects. And then you ask them, like, how'd that feel? Right. Did you write? Okay. Would you want the last ones that we did? Yeah, great. The slow one. I mean, not that you were slow. The last, or the first of those trials where I didn't even know it would read 20 RPMs. So, like, that was terrific. It expanded my range of knowledge. Okay, and then the other activity was where you guys, were moving weights in and out. And we talked somewhat extensively about that one last week, or maybe it was the week that we actually did it. And I would be more than happy to go over it again, if that's what you want. Or if you've seen that enough, or if there's anything that you would like to know about. Yeah.
So is our midterm doing that about the video that you're shooting tomorrow?
So what we're gonna do is like I'm gonna go and grab like some video of people's throwing things. I'm going to know how far it goes, and you're going to make a guess, not a guess, but you're going to estimate it or calculate how far you think it should go. And maybe there'll be prizes on top of grades for, like, who gets the best agreement. Because in my mind, it's possible to, like, have good success from an exam perspective without necessarily having the best numerical agreement. Let me say that. You know, it's not like I'm going to grade these by, well, that person was within 2 meters, this person, so that's an A, and this person was within 20 meters, so that's a D.
Oh.
Although, I know, yeah, I got you. That's why I'm not doing it like that. Like, I want, you know, for me, for these kinds of undertakings, the process is the part that's like the real, you know, indicative that you know what's going on. Because it's quite possible that, like, at the very beginning, you know, let's say something happens, and you didn't find the square root, let's say, of the calibration deal, you just found the, you know, you had some, like, oversight type error in the calibration, which is gonna make everything else, like, wrong. It doesn't stand a chance of being right. And that would be kind of unfortunate to, like, penalize you terribly for, like, an error that is, you know, mostly insignificant, except for numerical aspects of it, early on. Now, if you're gonna go and do this, like, professionally, you better get the numbers right, but, you know, this is not probably the first, not, maybe this is only time number 2 or 3 that you're doing this, so. Plus, no one failed. Or anybody, I should say it that way. Fail anybody, yeah.
So as we go down, we should be, like, explaining our methodology.
Yes, right. You know, like, I don't need to see this was the number, you know, this is the calibration value. But you can give it to me, that's fine. But, like, I would like an explanation of what the steps were. And if you want to have, like, the explanation of the steps and accompany with the numerical value that corresponds to, like, that completed step, that's totally fine. And then, you know, some, like, phrase, a discussion at the beginning, or I would guess, the beginning about what the, you know, the sort of mechanical relationships are that you were using also. Which in this case, I mean, we know it's projectiles, right? So we're going to talk about projectiles. Talk a little bit about the physics of that. And then, you know, you want to enhance your answer with, like, dolling it up a little bit with some of the aspects that we talked about last week. Go for it. Yeah.
Can you try to explain a little more clearly for me on how the one,
oh, yeah,
the activity, well, that's conservation momentum.
Angular momentum, yep. Okay. How about let's take that up in a sec because let's just make sure there's no, like, remaining issues with the, like, what we're going to do about momentum. Yeah.
So,
like
I said, so if we found the velocity, or
you're gonna make an estimate.
Oh, okay.
Right? That's like, that's your challenge. You figure out how far it goes, and I'm gonna know how far it goes. So it's gonna make me, what's that?
So physics.
It's gonna be that, yeah, largely physics.
Okay.
But this projectile deal is mostly physics. I mean, you can't really just, yeah. And, like, and motion capture.
Okay.
So it's both. So it's motion analysis, and because you're going to have to analyze that video in order to be able to tell how far.
So that's kind of like the experiment
is
finding out how we tell
it. Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. Your description, you could say it's quite similar to, like, the labs, So you should be like well practiced. I'm gonna give you like three different movies. You can pick whichever one you like. Maybe you have an affinity for baseball or javelins. I think we're good. Yeah, we got those two lined up. Somebody wants to throw a football. So like those are the implements that I see as that's something that you're gonna have. So this is a question that maybe you might have interest in. Kind of wants to know, are you ignoring air resistance? And a second ago, I was like, maybe you might want to doll up your answer, like beyond what we were in accordance with what we talked about last week, right? And that's what I've been referring to is, you know, you got this issue of air resistance. We aren't living in a vacuum. You're gonna know how fast that ball was traveling. I'll give you the, or whatever the implement is, I'll give you the linear dimensions of it. And you can make some decision as to whether or not like air resistance is gonna influence or not. Now, I'm not suggesting that you then like, you know, enter into the fray of the differential equations that would be necessary to like fully incorporate it. Could find those on the internet if you really wanted to. You want to geek out like that? It's up to you. But for like a, you know, maximum points, I'm not considering that a necessary step. It would be, I think, a decent idea to consider it because it probably is going to influence your estimate. To a greater or lesser extent, depending on whatever throw it is, right? Like if we have a shot put, which just to those of you who are not like familiar with track types of stuff, I guess it's really field, but the throws events in track and field, it's like a cannonball. You take a cannonball and you see how far you can heave it and you're supposed to have like a specific form for that. That thing doesn't, you know, in like non-Olympian type performers, it usually doesn't leave their hand very rapidly. As a result of that, and also its great mass, it's not going to, it's not going to have a whole lot of air resistance acting. A baseball that flies off like quite a bit faster in the hands of an accomplished player. For whatever reason, felt like it was okay to skip tonight's class. and so we'll just leave it at that. Is probably going to experience, you know, just like we talked about with the various different pitches that people use and are able to, like, you know, execute, rely on the aerodynamics. And so you just need to think about like, okay, how's that going to affect my estimate? Yeah, Ashley.
So is it the next Thursday?
Yeah, bring him with you. Okay. Yeah. That's a good question. Oh, wait a second. Sorry. No, the tradition is you get 7 days. So we'll have the moves out tomorrow, so you will have till next Friday. Okay. So you get the full week.
Maybe. So is
this
the last day next Thursday?
No. I think I don't like to have overlapping deadlines, overlapping assignments where you have two at the same time. So let's make this early next week. Yeah, because, you know, for the most, I think many of you were able to get most, if not all the way done. But hopefully with what we did today, that will, you know, alleviate it. And the other important reason for doing it sequentially is that like the motion analysis here is somewhat more easy than I think what you will need to do for the video on the exam, and it's probably good to like have done two or like have a sequence rather than, you know, do both sort of in a frantic moment and like you, you know, if you experience frustration or whatever, you don't overcome.
So we won't have lab that week?
We will have lab next week. Today is one of the days. We were going to go on a field trip, but the weather didn't cooperate. So it wasn't really going to be a lab where we, you know, all three sections come to the other time. Next week will be hydrodynamics. Fluids. Yeah.
So the exam is due next Friday and this lab is due early next week.
Yeah, so when early isn't really very descriptive, so should we pick a day? Wednesday, no, Wednesday, no, Wait, I mean, honestly, it doesn't matter to me. It's Saturday, it's going to grade them. So, what? Tuesday? All right, how about this? Show of hands. We're so democratic here. Tuesday. Preferred? Wednesday preferred. Seems like the Wednesday's happening. We'll accept them early. Also. Okay? So, by COP Wednesday, you can drop them downstairs in my mailbox or release. There's no limit to that. You're not charging for.
So, I should have money.
For these videos, yes. Except for, there was one group who was in section 3 who we were changing the Zoom around a little bit, and so they have two that they This, but some of you might be interested because at least two people have this thing. All right, let's go and do that again. Okay, so I have this video. This is a question about, like, if you go over the sort of the rationale behind the calibration. Right, because the question was, is the calibration number always the same? I mistook the intent to be like, for all of the class videos that we generated a couple of weeks ago, is it always the same? The answer to that is yes, except for this one instance in this first section where we were altering the Zoom. Right, because the relationship between like with the real world distances and pixels is dependent like on the zoom of the camera, how far away the object is from the camera. And so if you change any of those things, which is why we had like a little marker on the floor so that distance was always the same, and we didn't change the zoom in between. So it's always, though, it's going to, 182 is valid for almost all the class except for the guys that I talked about already. Now we go out and we take this in a baseball field or a football field somewhere, and the setup is going to be totally different and we're going to need to calibrate it again. And just as like FYI, every time we turn our cameras off and we turn it back on, we calibrate the system. And that's because when we use like two or three cameras to get 3D, calibrate the thing in a more complicated way, but we achieve an accuracy of less than like 2 millimeters. So, you know, in this big area here, we can like get it down to less than the width of a pin. So we have like high need for accuracy, and it's, and so if some kid, let's say of mine, is chasing down a doll that rolled across the lab floor and they happen to bump the tripod, which I don't think has yet happened, but if they were to do something like they bump the tripod where somebody's walking along and they do it inadvertently, then we have to have, you know, we need a record of that, and so we can't use the previous days for the next day. Okay, but how do you do this? So this is a this is an image of Nate holding a ruler, and the ruler has two marked reflective tapes on it. And I know what the distance is between them because I put those markers on. So it's 70 inches between the two. They're in 1 inch from the edge, and it's a 72-inch ruler. So these two points, this point here, right at the top, and this point right here, right at the bottom, are 72 inches away from each other. So when the movies you see tomorrow, well, we may have that exact one. You know, 6 feet is reasonably long, so we can get a pretty decent calibration. We might do something where we hold a tape measure, and we have like a black mirror, because usually when, like inside, you use something that is reflective and it looks white. Outside, because usually there's an abundance of light, you use black. So just as an FYI, the markers will likely be black on white background or lighter black background tomorrow. So we might have something where we use a tape measure and we have like a blacked out region of the tape or something like that, and then I tell you that the difference between here and there was 10 feet or 12 feet or 13.6 meters, you know, whatever it is, I don't know. Yeah. And so then you get the results of that digitization, the point locations. I'm just going to throw it right there. These are the points. You just find the segment length, relate that to the, so that gives you the number of pixels. You have the number of meters that was the space in between those two points. 70 inches ends up being something like 1.8 meters. And then you get your fraction by dividing the number of pixels in that segment by the linear distance in real life. Gives you a pixels per meter value, which then you can convert any pixel measurement into meters. Okay? That's all of it, everybody? Okay, cool. I forgot yours. So I'll do the conservation of angular momentum next, but like if you know some of you have already seen it, like Brittany, then feel free to stay or go. You don't need to get into the lab. There's a table. Yes, that, as long as you get into the building, it's there. So, yeah, we rolled the table in at the end of the night, but. Okay, so let's do that here.